Chester and Ellesmere Port, well, even the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, it's good to be together. It's traffic chaos out there. Sorry if we're a little bit later than usual starting this, but actually a lot of people have struggled to get here tonight. I know that people who are planning to come and want to come aren't here, but if you're able to hear us and see us and watch us on there, give us a like, a comment, or a wave, or a gif, or something like that, so we know that that there are people watching. It's good. We have some decorations here about the place. So there was a ladies' Bible study here this morning. It's good. That's also online. We'll be sharing that on YouTube later. And yeah, it's good. God is faithful.
Amen.
God is very mighty and powerful in there, every situation. So yeah, also if you're watching online and you've never been here, find us at ggechurch.co.uk or you can
come and visit us.
Find us on WhatsApp or Instagram. Come and visit us in real life, as Jim's just saying. Yeah.
Church Lane Backford.
Church Lane Backford, across the road from the other big church. We're the little church in the school
building.
But actually, you know, there is no little church.
No.
God is in the building, there's no little church.
Amen.
Let's pray. Let's give this time to the Lord and we'll just go forward with him. Heavenly Father, we just thank you, Lord, tonight. Thank you, Lord, that you are faithful. You are with us. You are our hero tonight.
Yes.
You are our sovereign, our creator, healer, our strength, our wisdom, our righteousness, Lord. All that we have is from you, Lord. All that we have is for you, Lord. And we give you this time now, Lord. You are in control. And we trust you, Lord. Whatever happens tonight, whoever manages to come, whoever doesn't manage to come, however things work out, we pray that you would clear the traffic.
Mm.
And we pray that you give peace of mind to those that would have desired to be here. Pray for Nigel tonight, Lord, a different one, Sean, Stephen Latimer, who's hoping to come, Ruby as well, and various others that are often are with us, Diane, and Sales, each one, Lord.
Yes, God.
We pray that you just really encourage now, minister to those that couldn't make it, Lord, and to those that could make it, thank you, Lord, that we have some voices in the room to react and prove that I'm not just here alone. Thank you, Lord. We praise you, Lord. We worship you now. Give us your heart this evening, we pray. Through your word, through your might, through your power, in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen.
Amen.
Okay, let's look tonight at Luke chapter 8. And we'll read a widely known story from verse 41. We're just going to read half a story.
Ooh, half a story.
And that there's two stories in one woven together here, but we're just going to focus on one part of it. So verse 41, it says, "And behold, there came a man named Jairus, and he was ruler of the synagogue, and he fell down at Jesus' feet and besought him that he would come unto his house, for he had one only daughter, about 12 years of age, and she lay a dying. But as he went, the people thronged him. And a woman having an issue of blood 12 years, which had spent all her living upon physicians, neither could be healed of any, came behind him and touched the border of his garment. And immediately her issue of blood staunched. And Jesus said, who touched me?" When all denied Peter and they that were with him said, Master, the multitude throng thee and press thee, and sayest thou, Who touched me? And Jesus said, Somebody hath touched me, for I perceive that virtue is gone out of me. And when the woman saw that she was not hid, she came trembling, and falling down before him, she declared unto him before all the people for what cause she had touched him, and how she was healed immediately. And he said unto her, Daughter, be of good comfort, thy faith hath made thee whole, go in peace. I'll leave it there. Yes, I know there's a good bit about the daughter being raised from the dead, but save that for another time, that's another story. But anyway, Heavenly Father, we thank you, Lord, for these words. Thank you, Lord, for your words of life, words of healing, words of truth, words of encouragement today. And Lord, we just want to give you this time. Thank you, Lord, for your faithfulness. Thank you, Lord, for your goodness, for all of the things you've done for us. Thank you for who you are. Thank you for your finished work on Calvary, that there is nothing we need to add to your work of redemption. Our salvation is dependent on you, Lord.
Amen.
Nothing of ourselves, nothing of any human effort, but on the grace of a perfect God, a loving Saviour. Thank you, Lord. We worship you tonight. Fill us with your Spirit. Touch us now, Lord, we pray. Lead us, guide us, and anoint with your Holy Spirit. We have no words, we have no ideas. We just trust on your word, your Spirit, your heart, that you will anoint every thought and every utterance from the throne of mercy. In the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. So, today it's Valentine's Day. The whole world is focusing on that, but we're not going to talk about that tonight. And it's also Ash Wednesday.
Yes.
And the people who are not celebrating Valentine's Day because they're far too spiritual are thinking about Ash Wednesday and giving up things for Lent and, you know, all of this season and the run up to Easter. But we're not going to talk about that either. So there you go. It's a special day for two reasons, but, you know, actually, you know what? Every day in the kingdom of God is a special day.
Amen.
We don't necessarily go with the calendar. Sometimes it can be helpful because it reminds us to read scripture. But to be perfectly honest, neither of these are particularly met with scripture. So, you know, let's focus on scripture, on God's word. Wow, Jesus is on the way to heal Jairus' daughter. She's lying at death's point. In fact, it's in Matthew's gospel, it says, my daughter is now dead. In other words, I think she's already died. But, you know, come, still come. That's an act of great faith. That actually this man who is the ruler of the synagogue, think about that, ruler of the synagogue, someone who has spent his whole life in religion and in religious acts and devotion, keeping the law and making sure other people kept the law and, you know, this whole thing and reading the scrolls and bringing them out. And yet, at this point, the religion gets him nowhere. He just has to trust on God. Relationship with the Saviour is what is going to make the difference here. Calling on someone, calling out to Jesus. And he does that, and we have this great story that Jesus is going to raise his daughter from the dead. But as I say, we're not talking about that either. So what are we talking about? We're talking about this story of this woman. This woman who comes as a sort of a background story, like a subplot almost, you might say. And she just comes very quietly, and she has a hope. She has a plan in her mind. I imagine she probably has not told anybody about this. It's between her and the Lord. It's something that God has put on her heart, and she thinks, you know what, if I can get to Jesus, I will try this. And in one sense you think, well, she has nothing to lose, does she? We're all a bit like that, actually. None of us have got anything to lose in this life, in trusting God, in trusting Christ as Saviour. It's like, well, really, what do we lose out on? Oh, but you can go in the world and party and do all the things that you want to do, be selfish. And no, it's not really losing out on that. Actually, trusting Christ as Saviour, we get so much more back, so much real life back. Wow. The story of this woman. You know what, I was thinking about this last night. People's stories move us. This is the point, isn't it? You know, we think about people's lives, people's situations. Jesus, it often says that he was moved with compassion when he saw the multitude. Why? Because he knew each one's story. The blind man, the leper, the sinful woman, whoever it was, the tax collector, the religious person, the scribe, he knew their story. The rich man, the beggar, the lame. Everyone has a story. And I think the older I get, the more I appreciate compassion and realize the need for compassion. We hear people's stories and they move us. Just different situations move to pray for people. You know, even recently, a few people got in touch. Somebody I work with lost their father. Somebody else told me that their mother has dementia. Someone else told me that privately that they said, I haven't told anyone else this, but I'm going through a divorce. And it's like, wow. You know, we don't know what goes on in people's lives. Someone else had a serious diagnosis as well. Someone else is having an operation. Someone else said their sister has cancer. You know, it's like the different things, different people. Sometimes we don't even realize, and sometimes, you know, like we have these people, so many characters from our life that actually, you know, we don't even know sometimes why we keep in touch with them. You know, it's like, oh yeah, it's like that's someone I used to work with 20 years ago, or that's somebody who I knew when I lived in the Midlands, or when I was in Prague, or somebody I met once or twice in Baltimore, or, you know, all sorts of different people from our background, from our life, that are a tapestry of our life. And it's great. It's a blessing, and it's a privilege, and it's an honor when people come and ask us to pray. You know, it's special. And we see people's stories, and we see the things that they go through. Jesus knows our suffering. He knows everything that we go through. Think about despised and rejected of men, a man of sorrows and acquainted with grief, and we hid, as it were, our faces from him. He was despised, and we esteemed him not. Surely he hath borne our griefs and carried our sorrows. Yet we did esteem him stricken, smitten of God, and afflicted. He was wounded for our transgressions, and he was bruised for our iniquities. The chastisement of our peace was upon him, and with his stripes we are healed. If only I hadn't planned to read that many verses, I was just going to quote Man of Sorrows. That was going to be it, you know. But we look back at those words and we realise actually how powerful they are. And one verse leads on to another, and we read it and we think, no, I can't stop there. Because we see what Christ has done for us. He knows everything that we go through. He knows our suffering. He's borne our suffering, our griefs. He is our healing. Oh, everything that we go through, he is aware of it. He has probably been through it himself. And we see Jesus here on the way to see a dying child. Now you might think, well, surely that would be enough for one day. A dying child, grieving parents. You know, a desperate situation. And he's there, he's going to the house. But, you know, before he gets there, there's an interruption. Quite ironic, isn't it? We're thinking about that tonight. Trying to get here by car tonight, and it's like, oh, the roads are all in chaos. For those that aren't aware, there's a lorry overturned on the M53, which means the traffic is all backed up and all the roads that join onto it are backed up, so every road is sort of blocked with traffic. It took me a very long time to get here from work. And you think, well, you know, we sort of get frustrated with it and think, well, why is this traffic not moving? You know, I can see the lights have changed down at the bottom of the slip road. Why can't I come off? I'm sitting there and crawling along and everything. But think about this. Jesus there, it says they thronged him. They thronged him. We can relate to that tonight. He's trying to get somewhere. And it's urgent. There's a child that is dying. There's a father that's desperate. There's a mother who's grieving. And Jesus is full of compassion, and he's the answer. And he knows that he alone is the only one who can deal with this situation. And he's trying to get there for love's sake. And yet what happens is, oh, the crowd are all in the way and everyone's trying to get near, and it's like he can't get through. And guess what? It ends up with a big delay. Wow. Yeah, there's a delay, and it's like nobody's going anywhere and he can't get through. Everybody's pressing and touching, and it's like, oh, you know. And then this woman comes along and she sees her opportunity. This woman might well have thought that she was invisible, in that she's nobody of consequence, probably not even well known in her own circle, her own family, her own friends, because she has had this thing for 12 years, this problem, an issue of blood. I like the way the King James calls it that, you know. I don't know what modern translations would say, but you know, they would probably give some diagnosis of what they think it probably means. So that's fair enough. But I like the fact that, you know, she has an issue. That's the old language, but actually today, we all have issues. Don't we? We all have issues.
Yeah.
And I remember Dr. Stephen saying years ago, this thing about an issue of blood, how actually things get in the blood. Again, it wasn't something I was planning to speak about, but you look in the Old Testament, there were certain sins that were blood guiltiness. David talks about that in Psalm 51.
Yeah.
Deliver me from blood guiltiness.
Yes.
Why? Because he committed adultery.
Yeah.
And a child had been born. And actually, if you look at adultery and various sins of sexual immorality and other things that are mentioned in the book of Leviticus, often, you know, it says, you know, you will stone them and their blood shall be upon them.
Yeah.
In other words, they're guilty of this, they've done this, and actually it's a blood sin, as it were. And it's like, wow. We all have an issue of blood. We've all sinned. We've all done things. And actually, the blood of the Lord Jesus Christ is all that is capable of cleansing us. Wow.
Yeah, amen.
Yeah. Now, if you go back to the book of Leviticus as well, you find that actually, but the issue that she had, it says if anybody has an issue, in other words, some sort of sore, disease that meant they are running, they either have, you know, discharge of bodily fluids of some sort or another, or blood or bleeding, then they're classed as unclean.
Clean.
They have to be kept out of the way of everyone else. Any bed, any seats, anything that she touches is automatically unclean. Clothes would be unclean. The house would be unclean. People who came into contact with her would be ceremonially unclean, like they would have to go and wash their clothes and be separated from everyone till the following day. So the point is, this woman has lived alone.
Yeah.
As someone no one would touch for 12 years. Now, when you think about it, you think about your life 12 years ago, where you were, what age you were. The other day, the London 2012 Olympics, that was 12 years ago.
Yeah.
It never was, surely.
yeah, it was.
You know, you think about it, it's like, wow, you might say, well, time flies, but then sometimes you think about, you know, 12 years, or do it this way, add 12 years on to your age. And calculate how old you will be in 12 years' time, and think, wow. Wow, what does that mean for me? You know, it's a big chunk of our life.
It
12
is.
Years.
It is.
When you think about it, it's massive. This woman, we don't know her age, but we do know this, that for 12 years she's lived with this problem. And it's a life-changing condition. It has destroyed her contact with people. It has destroyed her social life. It has meant that she doesn't have the same contact that regular people have. She can't take part in the ceremony. She can't go to the temple. She can't go to the synagogue. She can't meet with other women and fellowship. She can't maybe even be with her family necessarily. We don't know what the situation is, but she's alone. And probably for that reason, she feels that she can just slip in unnoticed. Nobody cares about me. Nobody notices that 12 years have gone by and nobody, you know. Maybe in the early days, old people kept in touch. How are you? And then as time goes on, it's like, oh, you still have that thing where we can't be in contact. Okay, yeah. You know, you haven't seen what's her face? Oh, 12 years ago. Oh, I haven't heard her in 12 years. It's like, wow, how quickly it goes. It's like, yeah. And she has this idea. If I can touch the hem of his garment, the tassel. Funnily enough, I think it was either this morning or yesterday morning, I was reading about that. I think it must have been this morning, because I don't think I'd read it when I studied for this. And it says, you know, you'll make a border on your garments, a ribband of blue, you know, and a fringe.
Mm.
Now, you see traditional Jewish shawls, prayer shawls,
mm-hmm.
and they have that blue and white stripe at the bottom,
mm-hmm.
don't they? And they have like a frilly edge, a tassely bit with my scarf on. Demonstrate with my scarf if I can. You know, yeah, they.
Yeah, it's got a tassel.
Yeah, it's got, these have got tassels on, okay. Oh, these are quite long ones, probably not. Yeah, it's got a Union Jack on for those. Watching from other countries, but anyway. Yeah, okay. But so the idea was, this woman thinks, right, if I can get close enough to Jesus, I don't have to hug him, I don't have to beg him, he doesn't have to heal me, doesn't have to lay hands on me, doesn't have to pronounce, doesn't have to shout over me, doesn't have to speak to me, doesn't even have to know that I'm there. But all I want is, I want to just touch the fringe, the little bit on the end. Wow. And that will be enough for me. That will be enough.
Wow.
Yeah. And so, yeah, she does that, she comes near. And she has a measure of faith. Jesus says, you know, if you have faith as a mustard seed,
yeah.
you can say to this mountain, be removed. Or say to this mulberry tree, be pulled up by the roots and planted into the sea. And it's like, yeah, okay, good. A small degree of faith. It doesn't have to be a lot. This woman, you know, I'm not going to ask for much. Just going to have a small touch. That's all. That's all I need. But to her, it is everything. To her, that one moment. Reaching out and touching Jesus, it changes her life.
Yeah.
But Jesus feels the power go out of him. It says virtue here, and I think a lot of the King James Version is translated as virtue,
mm-hmm.
as in goodness.
Yeah.
The word I think is dunamis in the Greek, which is power. For those of you that want to study the Greek words, dunamis, we get our word dynamite from it. Dynamo,
yeah.
dynamic, all of these words that are about power and
yeah.
life and forces. Yeah, we still use these words today. But yes, power went out of Jesus. But he felt it. That's the interesting point. He felt this life force, this healing life force, leave him and heal someone. It's almost as if Jesus has got this power on him to heal this, to heal Jairus' daughter. And it's like, oh, hang on, who took that? Where did it go? Now we know actually Jesus is God. He's
yeah,
enough. It's not like he's going to, oh, I've run out, oh, I'll have to go get some more now. No, that's not, you know, he has a limitless supply from the Lord.
Amen.
Although he is in human form. And, you know, he was limited to his humanity by choice. But actually, you know, it's like, but he knows that someone has been healed. And he stops and says, you know, who touched me?
Yeah.
And Peter is slightly sarcastic and says, Lord, come on, for goodness sake, you're in a crowd full of people, everyone's pressing you, thronging you, pushing you, touching you, and you are sort of saying, who touched me? And it's like, but I like the way Jesus' response is written here. Because he sort of said, no, somebody touched me.
Yeah.
I felt it, I know. It's like, And I'm going to make a point of this.
Yeah.
Somebody touched me. You know, that somebody came for healing.
Mm.
Somebody
yeah.
came with an issue. And they wanted my help. And I know that I've been able to help them. And it's like, wow.
Wow.
Yeah.
That's amazing.
Somebody touched me. For I perceive that virtue is gone out of me.
Mm. Wow.
And then we have this situation where this woman, first of all, everyone says, no, it wasn't me. I've been here. Okay, fine. And then finally this woman says that she sees, she realizes that it's not going to be hid. This woman that spent probably most of her life hiding, maybe even hiding from God a little bit, but she realizes that she can't hide anymore, and she comes forward fearful, trembling,
mm-hmm.
and she admits that it was her that did this. She thinks she's probably going to get into trouble, but also she tells how she was healed immediately. She knew. Sometimes we just know when we're better from something.
Yeah.
I don't know
yeah.
whether we've experienced that. Sometimes, you know, sometimes we have these situations and we think, oh, I don't know whether I'll ever get better from this.
Yeah.
We live with it for a long time. And sometimes we get gradually better of something and we just realise, oh, I don't do that, you know, I don't have that problem anymore.
Mm-hmm.
And we don't even realise when it was. But there are times when something happens and suddenly we know that we're better.
Wow.
Like a bone clicking back into place and it's like, oh, suddenly I'm better. Or like, you know, we wake up and problem that was there is gone. This woman knew immediately that the flow of her blood had been staunched. Now again, we don't know where she was bleeding from. It might have been an intimate place. It probably wasn't a place that was on show. I'm sure she didn't go walk around with an open wound anyway, but she knew immediately. She didn't have to check. Knew that actually the touch from the Lord Jesus Christ was enough for her, and that she'd been healed immediately. And she also confessed that.
Yeah.
And Jesus says to her, you know, daughter, be of good comfort. Thy faith had made thee whole. Go in peace.
Mm.
Okay. So first of all, be of good cheer. Okay, I'm afraid. I spent all my life skulking. A lot of my life maybe depressed or discouraged by the fact that I've tried every doctor. I've tried every physician. I've given all my money to different people who said they were going to heal me. And nobody has come through. But Jesus says, no, be of good cheer.
Mm.
Now is the time for joy. Now is the time to rejoice. Now is the time to actually say, hey, these problems that I have, they're gone.
Amen.
Because actually I've found the Saviour. And the problems are gone. Be of good cheer. It says your faith has saved you. Your faith made you whole. It's about your faith. You know, this is the point. John 14, it says, let not your heart be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me. Now, this woman had come to Jesus because she believed that he was a man of God. And she believed she could be healed by touching the edge of his garment. Again, a small touch, not a big thing, just the very least part would be enough.
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. If you believe God, believe in Jesus as well. Believe in him. Your faith has made you whole. And also think about this. He says, your faith has made you whole. You know, when we come to the Lord Jesus Christ, when we discover him, we are made whole.
Wow, thank you, God.
You know, there is healing. We can be physically healed of ailments and problems and issues. We can be forgiven of sins and have habits broken, characters broken, attitudes changed. Many things in our life can be healed. But actually, all of this is the process of being made whole. Like Colossians 2:9 says, you know, we are complete in him. Complete in him. We are complete in him. Hallelujah. Anyway. I'd end up singing something like that. But yeah, no, it's like, it's there, yeah, that's it.
Yeah,
we're in Christ, we need nothing else.
Hallelujah.
We are bought with the blood of Christ. And our healing is not just partial, we are made whole.
Thank you.
We are made complete, we are made perfect in him. It's not a partial, it's not a maybe, it's not a half-hearted thing. It's like, no, we're made whole. Yeah, like the jigsaw with all the bits put in the right place, and there's a certain sense of satisfaction, isn't there, when you complete the jigsaw and it's there and it's like, you are, no bits missing. That's it. Your faith has made you whole. But this as well was actually the reason that I preached on this tonight. Go in peace. That was actually going to be the main text. We've sort of come to it at the end now. But, you know, sometimes God has a way of turning the message around backwards from where we think we're going to preach them. Anyway, but go in peace. It's interesting actually, because the previous chapter, Jesus says this again. There it's the sinful woman who is come into the house. You remember the story of Simon the Pharisee, and the sinful woman comes in, and she's obviously a person of very bad reputation. And she kneels at Jesus' feet and washes his feet with her tears, dries them with her hair, and the Pharisee is sitting there saying, well, this man was really a prophet. He would know what sort of woman this is that's touching him. And Jesus says to him, Simon, do you see this woman?
Wow.
Do you see a person? Not an issue, not a problem, not a lifestyle choice, not activity, not, oh, this is what she's done, this is who she is, this is her reputation. I know about people like her. No. It's just, hey, do you see this woman?
Wow.
Do you see this person? You know, somebody was trying to argue with me the other day because I'd said a comment about the difference between Islam and Christianity. And they're sort of saying, so you hate all Muslims and you're racist and things like that. I said, no. One, don't make it about race, because faith is beyond race. There are Muslims of many different ethnicities. You know, there are European Muslims, there are American Muslims, there are, you know, Middle Eastern, African, Asian, you know, it's like, it's not about race at all, ever. Don't let anyone say that. And also, I said, I know individual Muslims. I have friends who are Muslim. not about that. It's not, we deal with a person,
mm.
not with a, but it means we can criticise an ideology.
Yes.
Or a belief system.
Mm-hmm.
We can say that we don't agree with certain principles,
absolutely.
Certain teachings.
Mm-hmm.
That is fine. But people twist in this day and age, they twist it into, you hate this person and you hate me and everyone like me. No, that's never the case.
Mm-hmm.
Because Jesus deals with people.
Yeah. Yeah.
And this story here mm-hmm. of the sinful woman in Luke 7 makes that very apparent.
Mm-hmm.
Simon, do you see this woman?
Mm-hmm.
She, you gave me no kiss, but she has kissed my feet. You gave me no water to wash my feet, but she had washed my feet with her tears.
Yeah.
Mm.
And he says, thy sins are forgiven thee.
Yeah.
And he says to her in verse 50, thy faith hath saved thee, go
in peace.
Exactly the same thing as he says to this woman who has been healed of the issue of blood. Thy faith has saved thee, go in peace. This is it. You know, you see this again. You know, I was going to do a study on Go in Peace, but it's too big actually. There are lots of fun, you know. From the Old Testament, you know, people, you know, David saying to them, Jonathan, go in peace, you know. Yeah, great. There are lots of them. So that's another time. But people come with an issue, people come with a situation.
Yeah, keep going.
Don't be afraid to bring your issue. Don't be afraid to come.
Mm.
If other people condemn you, if other people disown you, if other people accuse you, come to the Lord Jesus Christ. Jesus is the one who will forgive. Jesus is the one who will restore. Jesus is the one who can heal. And Jesus is the one that will make us whole. Have faith. Get whole. Go in peace.
Wow.
Actually, fear not. You know, don't be afraid.
Mm.
Have faith. Get whole. Go in peace. Wow. Back to John 14, verse 27. Peace I leave with you, my peace I give unto you, not as the world give I unto you. Let not your heart be troubled, neither let it be afraid. He goes back to the beginning, the opening of that chapter. The two go together. No trouble, no. Worry, no concern, just peace. Romans 15, verse 13, it says, now the God of hope fill you with joy and peace in believing, that we may abound in hope through the power of the Holy Spirit. On the end of that chapter it said, now the God of peace be with you all. Amen.
Mm.
We started off thinking about different people's situations. You know, people who've lost loved ones, people who are facing severe illness. Different people that we encounter. We have compassion on them. Their stories move us. But you know what? We have the God of peace.
Mm. Wow.
The God of peace be with you all. We don't have much to offer people, do we? I'm not a medical doctor. I can't heal somebody. I'm not a millionaire. What's the name of the guy? Is it Mr. Beast or something that goes around giving out his money to people He's sort of famous, but I don't know even know how he got his money. He's just famous for giving out lots of money to people. Oh, it's great, you know, it's fun. Okay, you know, we're not like that.
Yep.
We don't know, we don't have that to give people. You know, we don't have great counsel. We're not degrees in psychology or anything like that. You know, no, but what we can give people is the Lord Jesus Christ, the God of peace. That's it. That's simplicity.
Mm.
That's it. But the Lord Jesus Christ, he's the one that makes us whole.
Mm.
Amen.
Amen.
Yeah, Heavenly Father, we just thank you, Lord, that you are the God of peace. You are our peace.
Yes, God.
Thank you, Lord, that you see our situation, whatever we have been in, whatever we've done, whatever we're going through, whatever the future may hold for us, our worries, our concerns, our anxieties. Lord, you are the God of peace.
Thank you, God.
Lord, when there is trouble on the horizon, when there are people in our lives that are going through things, Lord, we bring them to you, Lord. There is nowhere else to put them. We leave them in your loving care, Lord. We pray for different situations. Pray for the family going through a divorce. We pray for another family where they have lost their father. Pray for another friend who has a sister with cancer. Someone else whose mother was in hospital. Someone who actually had, their parent has dementia. Pray for Stephen as well as he goes through his operation.
Yes, God.
In the next few days on Friday.
Yes, God.
Cover their, Lord, we pray. Give peace of mind.
Mm.
Give healing, Lord.
Mm. Yes, God.
You are the one that makes whole. The doctors, the surgeons can do so much. But healing is with the Lord.
Hallelujah. Mm.
It's you, Lord. You can knit the bones together. You can knit the flesh back together.
Mm.
You control the flow of blood, Lord.
Mm. Thank you.
Lord, we give everything into your
hands.
Lord. We love you. We trust you. For any others that are going through these situations at the moment, Lord, be with each one.
Mm.
We want to lift up Lindsay.
Yes.
And, we want to think of Sandrine as well.
Mm.
People who used to be here with us. Now in different parts of the world, but Lord, we still pray with them, for them.
Mm.
We think of Laura and Scott, Michelle.
Yes,
and Singapore, Lord.
Oh,
just
God,
for his situation,
yes,
Lord, full healing there as well.
Yes, God.
Touch, we pray, for each one, Lord.
Hallelujah.
For every situation. Those that we know about, those that maybe we don't know about.
Yes, God.
People's private situations.
Yeah.
People like this woman who maybe have told nobody what their issue is.
Mm.
They don't want to make it public. They just want to quietly come and be touched by the Lord, healed by the Lord.
Mm.
Thank you, Lord.
Thank you, Lord.
And Lord, we pray now, if there's anyone watching as well who has never trusted Christ as their Saviour, who doesn't fully understand what it is to be made whole. Whole in the heart, whole in their mind, whole in their personality, whole in their whole being, their soul, every part, their spirit, their body. Lord, we just pray that this would be the time for people to cry out and say, Lord, I want to be made whole. I have a little faith. I put my faith in the Lord Jesus Christ. I trust the God who laid down his life for me.
Amen.
I trust the one who loves me.
Mm.
And I ask, Lord, that you come into my heart now.
Mm.
In the name of our Lord Jesus